get started. So who am I? I'm a maintainer of Fluentd. You can also say I'm a community manager or a mailing list person. The preceding talk about managing open source really resonated with me. And I work for this company called Treasure Data. I won't talk much about it, but if you guys were to take one thing away about Treasure Data, they're cool enough to have me focus entirely on open source. So, cool folks. And I'm a former quant at a hedge fund, and I think the term du jour is I was a data scientist in finance for 3 years. And last but not least, I'm fairly new to Ruby, so Tom's talk was, well, I mean, the whole Monad thing aside, it was like quite a bit of Ruby for me. And just to show like how much of a noob that I am, here's a conversation me and Zach Scott, who's a maintainer of Ruby. I didn't know that Ruby had a Lambda until a few weeks ago, so please be easy on me. So what is data science? Whenever I don't know the definition of a term, because I'm a mathematician, I do what all the mathematicians do, which is I go to Twitter for definitions. Data scientist, a data analyst who lives in California. 137 people resonate with that feeling. But like, we can do better, right? We can be a little more serious. So. Here's a pretty good one, actually, by Josh Willis of Cloudera. Data scientist is a person who's better at statistics than any software engineer, and better at software engineering than any statistician. Pretty smart. 896 people like that. But my personal favorite, and those are both really good, and I honestly didn't think like how much laugh I could get with those. So I have the third one, which is Big Data Borat. And a little like spoilers of sorts, which is this talk is not going to be about data science proper. I really like Azure's talk about the statistics, and it really behooves to have like a solid understanding of statistics, even if you're programming like back end or databases or distributed systems or like front end day to day, because it really like puts numbers in context. But what I want to talk about today is actually before that, before you get to like do the whole number crunching and model building and hypothesis testing, which is I want to talk about log data. So how many of you have like grep through logs or like typed in like less stuff? All right, cool, right? Like we all love that stuff, right? So I want to share like two anecdotes from my own professional life. And the first story is me, myself, and log data. So before I came to the bright side of the industry, that is Silicon Valley and startups, I worked in the dark side as a quantitative analyst at a hedge fund. And my job looked like this. So I'm supposed to get data, and I do a whole bunch of like number crunching, model building, and I ruminate on the outputs, and I share my findings or lack thereof with my manager and like partners and other traders. But in reality, I spend like 80% of the time just doing that, which is, I don't know if the font is too small, but acquiring data and reformatting, cleaning it, and rinse and repeat. So I like flowcharts. So here's a flowchart. Acquire data, and this is like 9 a.m. And you realize there's an encoding issue. And I would understand like if I'm like doing like sentiment analysis on like tweets, right? No, I'm looking at stock market data. Like this shit should be in like ASCII. Like, I have no idea what I was doing, but. Like, it's fine. I'm going to write a script. And because I was a quant, I would use Python and not Ruby. Then I realized there's, like, some deeper level issue. Like, the stock market was crossed, meaning the price that you can buy is actually, like, above the price at which some, like, you can basically buy and sell and make a profit for half, like, half of the day. And that makes no sense. Like, you realize that there's some issue with data. So you go into the database, and you like sort of work with engineers, and you get very, very frustrated. And you say, you know what? Like one time, it's like, screw this. Like, I'm going to just try to do this on my own. So I talked to Kurt, who's a really good engineer. Kurt, just give me access to all the logs. I'm going to do it. And he's like, are you sure, Kiyoto, you want to do that? He's like, yeah, I'm going to do it. And it's like, holy shit. Kurt has a very, very interesting job. And that actually really made me think about why it's so hard to actually make data useful. And part of it is, it is not entirely clear when you start out, like, what's useful and what's not. But humans have this tendency to just, like, shove everything into something, right? And this was shoved into something, but it's impossible for, like, a business person like myself, my former self, to directly work with this. So I would work with other people, and other people are not exactly the people who get business value from it. And, like, you sort of, like, pass around the hot potato, and nothing gets done. So the second story is from my time spent at Treasure Data and Fluentd, working with people who really want to use log data to do stuff. So they're like, ah, we're all about logs and metrics and this and that. And I call this M&M, not the chocolate, which I got earlier here, but metrics and monitoring. Everyone loves metrics. And everyone also loves monitoring, because if you're monitoring, you can see that all the troubles coming in your direction. So it's not a bad idea to subscribe to this mantra that, you know, log everything, right? Like, log this data, log that data. Like, I'm spinning up a new service. Oh, like, is logging everywhere in that? It's like, are you sure, like, we have all the information later? The problem is, if it's like a three-person startup, sure, it works. But usually it's like this. There are different people in the organization, and they have different needs for log data. Like, VPs probably want the top-line numbers. Operations folks want to know, for example, like HA proxy, concurrent number of connections, and you would ask about HA proxy to product managers, and they'd be like, HA what? Right? And what happens is, like, everyone's like, you know what, I'm going to start collecting my own logs, just like my former self, right? Like, Kurt, get out of my way. I'm going to try to do it. And when everyone starts doing that in the team, what you get is something like this. Like, it sort of works. Like, day to day, like, as long as nobody touches it, it works. Because, like, that one Perl script, and it's always Perl. Like, the 200 lines of Perl that Dan wrote 6 years ago that nobody else touched works. As long as you bug Dan, it's like, hey, the format changed, so can you change that regular expression? It's like, yeah, no problem. I'm going to go to line 120 and change that regex, and it would all work. But basically, what I'm here to convince you is that there are ways to do it better. And with some, like, modestness, I would say that Fluentd is one such solution. And I really mean that Fluentd is one such solution. There are so many other ways to do it. There's different paradigms. And I could talk about that, but I want to do a demo later. So if you want to talk about different ways to centralize logging and, like, build a unified logging layer, come find me at a party or tomorrow. So I'll just talk about Fluentd here. So how does it work? One thing about, like, one misconception about mathematicians is that we love the abstract, like, we love monads. But the thing about it is, mathematicians are trained to anchor discussions to, like, concrete examples. Just like Tom did this morning. Like, that was very easy to understand. I finally have an educated guess of what monad is. Yeah. So I'm going to start with a very simple example, which is a Apache log, because everyone's at least seen it, right? And it looks kind of like this. And whoever came up with this thought it was a brilliant idea, because it's very clear that 200 is a status code and not just like a random number. Like, seriously, right? Like, I think for the longest time, I didn't even know what different fields were, other than the last thing, which is like a user agent, I guess. But so what Fluentd does is like it processes like semi-structured or structured, like ill-structured messages like this, and parse it into a JSON. And of course, you have to supply the logic as to how you do it. It's usually based on regex, but you can also write your own parser in Ruby. So once you do that, all the data sources are parsed into JSON. But then the question is, OK, so you're getting the data, and you're getting an Apache log data, and you don't know where you want to put it. Or like you might want to put it into two systems. Or all you want to do is just put it into a centralized log server. But like Fluentd has to know like how to put the data into the right destination. And if I could abstract it, whether it's Fluentd or not, the system needs to have a very intelligent and scalable way of knowing where the data originates and which data should go to which system. So how Fluentd does this is it's based on two things. One is timestamp, but more importantly, it's based on this idea of tagging each event. So each event is actually a triple. It has a timestamp, and John talked a lot about timestamp. I used to live in Illinois, and I didn't know Indiana had like two bajillion time zones. But then the second is more important, which is a tag, which is assigned by the input source. Then there's the bulk of the data. In this case, it's like a method, path. So 200 is the status code, and 140 is the size. And so to answer the question of how do you get the data in to different systems, there's a way to tag it. So if you're sending data to MongoDB, you're going to probably tag it as MongoDB. If you're sending data to Hadoop, you're going to tag it as HDFS. So this is pretty much it. But I know I have like 15 minutes left. So what I'm going to do is a live demo. And one disclaimer is that I've never given a talk to an audience this large. And I've definitely not done a live demo to an audience this large. So we'll see. But hopefully it's interesting. At least like you guys can see me fail before you guys are going to go to like the party. Aha, that last speaker here is demo generally. Right. All right, so as some of you might know, or obviously all of you are cool enough to come to this one and not the one in Japan, but there is Ruby Kaigi going on, which is like a pretty big Ruby event. And like I love both events. My coworker is actually at Ruby Kaigi. But in terms of logistics, I must say GoGaRuCo has an upper hand, because I just saw this tweet this morning as I woke up. like they're missing the big dad, right? And I don't know if this was intentional or not, but the title of Matt's talk was coming soon. And like there's so many ways to interpret this. It's like he was coming soon, or like he wasn't sure what the title was going to be, or like maybe like the features of Ruby that are coming soon, or maybe mRuby. But what I want to do is, and I need to put a disclaimer, which is I do a lot of demos for Fluentd, but every time I use like Nginx or Apache logs as like the example data sources, like half the people are like, oh, that's cool. Like you guys are solving my problem. And the other half is like, it's just like web server logs. Like I don't care. So I thought I would come up with data sources that everyone would care. And that is, I'm going to collect Twitter data streams with the hashtags GoGaRuCo and Ruby Kaigi. And I'm going to use Kibana and Elasticsearch to plot it so that if we have fewer tweets, you guys can stop listening to me and start tweeting frantically so that we can like out-tweet them. So without further ado, wish me luck. So one thing that we did recently with Fluentd was like, it's like 3 years old, and for the first 2.5 years of its life, it had this like incredibly intuitive command line interface for everything. And some people liked it, a lot of people liked it. Some people prefer something that a little more visually driven. So we made one. It's called the Fluentd UI. And I started, it's actually a Rails app. And when I go there, I'm supposed to sign in. There you go. Haha. So it is a way to like launch, stop, and configure Fluentd inside a web browser. So how many of you are familiar with Splunk and Splunk Forwarder? The idea is similar, except you don't have to pay a dime for this thing. Splunk is a great piece of software, by the way. I have nothing evil to say about them. So what I'm going to do here is, like, there are a bunch of items here. And like, let's look at installed plugins, because plugins is what enables Fluentd to listen to many sources. So there are three that I have pre-installed. One is for Elasticsearch, and one is for, it's called Record Reformer. It does like lightweight filtering in stream. And another is like one for Twitter, so that I can listen to Twitter data stream. And if I go to config file, there's a config file, but it's like, it's not, so there's one feature, like I'm waiting for a pull request, like try to color the thing. And here's a uncolored but larger font version. So the stuff inside source is data source, so data inputs. So it says type, so there's a little bit of DSL for Fluentd, and there's my consumer key, OAuth token. You can steal those now and like do evil things on Twitter on my behalf. And I'm sampling the timeline and looking for the keyword GoGaRuCo, and I'm tagging it. And this was a concept from earlier. And yeah, so that's going to be called twitter.gogaruco. And if you go down, there's one for Ruby Kaigi. And now match is how Fluentd knows which output systems to send it to. And it has wildcards, so everything that starts with Twitter, it matches. And there's a little bit of bookkeeping. And this is purely technical, because I want to show the Twitter data stream for Ruby Kaigi and GoGaRuCo in different colors in Elasticsearch. But this is like technicality. Then you reroute this message into Elasticsearch, and here's like a little bit of parameters. So I am going in here and start this thing. Well, before I start that thing, well, I should stop that thing and start Elasticsearch. So I'm going to launch Elasticsearch. And as always, it's very easy to start, although I have no idea what the logs are saying most of the time. And I'm going to start this. Hooray, it's running. And if I go to logs, it should have logs, but the log says, it says log is empty, so I just go ahead. And because I'm at GoGaRuCo, I'm going to use simple Python server to spin up Kibana. And let's see if this thing's going to work. All right, so I have the default screen. So there's a little bit of, haha, it's there. There are 7 hits per minute. And nobody seems to be tweeting with GoGaRuCo right now. So hey, everyone take out your smartphones and start tweeting about GoGaRuCo. I'll be here. I still have 9 minutes. Okay, I'm going to tweet myself. I am at GoGaRuCo on stage trying to make my demo work. Oh, it could be anything. It should be looking for just the string. Sorry for my... So my day job is a marketer, so I have a tendency to gloss over technical details. All right, cool. That looks pretty good. Oh, I need to capitalize this thing. Hooray. At least my tweet should show up. No, why is not GoGaRuCo? Okay. At least there's data. There is data. So this is basically my presentation. I can go on and on and wonder why GoGaRuCo is not showing up here. But yeah, and going back to the presentation. Yet another reason I shouldn't use PowerPoint. Can you guys see it? It says it crashed. So so basically, what I wanted to convey is that log data is actually everyone's concern in an organization. And this is very hard to feel, especially your team is big, and especially when you have messy about working data pipeline. But also, as someone who experienced like how inefficient it can be, it really pays huge dividends to revisit how you guys log and filter and use data. And there are lots of tools out there. Fluentd is one option. And I'd love to hear how you guys are doing stuff. And I don't know why that is showing up, because mine is still crashing. Lesson number, what? There could be. Let me see. Config file. No, I think that is right. So this is one of those things that, like, I expected my demo to completely, like, not work. It semi-worked, so that's pretty good. And my parting message, obviously, is do not use Microsoft PowerPoint when you're presenting on... No. Let me finish my sentence. When you're presenting on the MacBook Air. Thank you very much, and have a great party.